know, it feel good when you recognize. I just wanted to be recognized. 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 Now I'm having recognition.
Recognition, recognition.
Now I'm having recognition. Recognition, recognition.
All right, folks, welcome back. In this video, we're going to look at two critiques of Will Kimlicka. One, libertarian critique by John Tomasi, which we're going to look at really very briefly. And then most of the video on a much deeper critique from Charles Taylor that suggests that Kimlicka simply misunderstood what people find to be of value to begin with. Now, the gist of this second critique is that Kimlicka thought he was escaping older versions of liberalism, thought he was crafting one that truly respected and accommodated people from all cultural backgrounds. But Taylor argues that really any view based on Rawlsian self-respect and the choosing individual is going to get people wrong. What people want is not choice and a vague sense that they are respected. Respect is a start, but it's just not enough. People want, Taylor says, recognition. They want people to see them as valuable for who they are, as people deeply enmeshed in their very particular cultures, not as people who are valuable because they are individual choosers who happen to need a culture in order to be individual choosers. And here's the weird thing that you'll see in these videos. Both of these critics, who otherwise wouldn't agree with each other on much, they don't agree on how to respect people or to recognize people, they do agree on one big flaw in Kimlicka. They both focus on the idea that he just doesn't care intrinsically if a culture breaks down and goes away. And Kimlicka is clear. He is arguing this. He cares only to the extent that the people in the culture care and lose their context of choice by the disintegration of their culture. But there's nothing valuable in the culture in and of itself. Neither of our critics say that there is something of value in the culture in and of itself, but this is where their criticism of Kimlicka focuses and begins. So let's see what these two criticisms are. Now, John Tomasi actually agrees with Kimlicka on the point I just stated. Cultures could break down and go away, no problem for him. Nothing of intrinsic value lost. He simply says Kimlicka contradicts himself on this issue. So Tomasi says that Kimlicka actually harbors an unspoken assumption that cultures should be protected from change, protected from ever disintegrating, really. And he says we therefore have to throw out Kimlicka's views because it in fact assumes a value for cultures in and of themselves that even Kimlicka denies would be appropriate for a liberal. The view rests, Tomasi says, on an illiberal value for cultures, so he thinks we should just return to earlier liberalisms. On page 588 of one of the optional readings, Tomasi speaks of an example that Kimlicka uses in his first book. It was called Liberalism, Community, and Culture. And Kimlicka there had spoken of an Inuit girl whose culture was rapidly transforming via pressure and some integration with white Canadians. And Kimlicka says, well, this was happening from when she was 2 to when she was 18. And Kimlicka says her culture is under threat. He says this in that book, the existence of the cultural community in which she grew up is likely to be undermined. And he says that the threat here is that the way she understands herself as Inuit will be destabilized. But Tomasi responds, using Kimlicka's own theory, that this can't really be any threat to her. If it's true that we understand ourselves in the context of cultural meanings surrounding us, and that as we mature, we take on an identity, then this girl really just grew up with some understandings that were traditional Inuit understandings and some that came from white Canadians. Neither could possibly be more true of her, who she is, and how she understands herself will be in relation to both of those cultures. Her Inuit grandparents may not understand some of her actions as Inuit, but her white Canadian peers will understand those very same actions as Canadian. And for sure, she may be troubled by that distance from her grandparents, but she's not somehow an insecure, destabilized person because of it. And frankly, a lot of us experience distance from our grandparents and their culture. And Tomasi says that the root of this problem in his theory is in a philosophical inconsistency in Kimlicka's argument. Kimlicka starts by saying that a person simply needs a cultural context in order for their life to gain meaning, but then he soon switches to saying that we need a secure cultural context. So Tomasi expresses the fear on 587 to 588 that this would seem to put a lot of power in, say, for instance, the elders of a community to define how cultures were in the past and how that culture should then continue to be transmitted securely into the future. Any given culture is what it is. Security only matters from some abstract perspective of the community, the culture, or a group. And again, a group usually dominated by male elders. Not from the perspective of the individual. Any given individual's culture just is what it is. The Inuit girl's culture just is the many influences upon her. So Kimlicka can't say that he cares about this individual if he's giving the power to others in the Inuit community or in the collective as a whole to invoke external protections against the white Canadians who have influenced her. That's an imposition on her, not a protection of her. If it's a protection for anyone, it's a protection for her grandparents and their sense of what is secure in their culture. Now, Taylor also pinpoints his criticism of Kimlicka on that same view that there's nothing intrinsic about a culture that's worth saving. But his criticism isn't that Kimlicka contradicts himself, and so we therefore shouldn't lump in for these sort of special protections of culture. And it's not that we should go the other way either and impute some sort of special value to cultures, intrinsic to them, just because they meet the definition of what is a, quote, culture. Instead, Taylor says, in a footnote you'll want to look at on page 40, that Kimlicka's lack of regard for the longevity of cultures just shows that he doesn't value cultures for the reasons that people themselves would. People themselves do, in fact, want to see their cultures persist. And so we may have to rethink what it is that they're valuing about their cultures. It's not just that that culture is a context for their choices. It's that they want to see that culture outlive even them. And they may, in fact, want to see their children, not to mention other people's children, embrace that culture too. So Taylor says that what people really want is recognition from others. As he says on page 25, real damage, real distortion is done to a person if the people or society around them mirror back to them a confining or demeaning or contemptible picture of themselves. So in a sense, people want you to value their culture as they see it. And they want you to reflect back to them in the way that you look at them, that you value them, and maybe even that you love them for what they love in themselves, the cultural things that give them meaning. To do this, as we're going to see in a moment, Taylor says that you have to be open to expanding your horizons and seeing their culture as valuable in the way that they do. So Taylor starts his essay with a lot of history of philosophy, admittedly. Let me tell you what it all means. You may not have seen all the names before, Hegel, Herder, Kant, Gadamer, and etc. Rousseau's name you have seen before, so you could look at that section on him. It's on pages 44 to 50. But here's the basic point. Taylor says that throughout history, really, philosophers have always identified the need for recognition from others as the core of really whatever value systems they've advocated for. In an aristocratic society, for instance, perhaps recognition from others means honor, recognition from the aristocrats that one possesses their same virtues. In democratic societies, he says, we've simply moved towards equal recognition. So for instance, calling each other Mr. and Mrs., or talking to each other as ladies and gentlemen, terms that we stole from an older aristocratic society. There aren't really ladies and gentlemen out there in the older aristocratic sense, but we've co-opted that term, as it were, to signal we're just as good as them, all of us. So Taylor says we use all of those forms of respect to signal our equality. And via that history of philosophy, he's essentially arguing that he's found something that's true about people, not unlike a Geertz or a Levi-Strauss would say. So he says on page 32 that human life is fundamentally dialogical. He says, we become fully agents, capable of understanding ourselves and hence defining our identity through our acquisition of rich languages of expression. Yeah, this is influenced by structuralism, but it's not pure structuralism. What he says is important is not that signifier and signified sort of define and delimit our lives, but that when we speak, we're trying to be known by others. He says this on pages 32 to 33. We define our identity always in dialogue with, sometimes in struggle against, things our significant others want to see in us. There are two sides to this, of course. There are always two sides in a dialogue. The first side is what I would label ascriptive identity. The social identity we have is, in part, the one that's been ascribed to us by others. So if you see me in a particular way, that defines who I am to you. But Taylor says, the other side is that we actually internalize this. So think about the voice of your parents sort of playing in your head, telling you, you have to be this and do that. It guides you, and not always externally. Sometimes it literally becomes who you are. So we can tie this back to our video on Kimlicka by noting here that Taylor thinks that he can explain love better than anyone else. In that video, I said, maybe Kimlicka had a difficult time making sense of love if he would say that love is chosen. Taylor says on 36 that relationships are key to what he calls self-discovery and self-affirmation. He says this, love relationships are not just important because of the general emphasis in modern culture on the fulfillment of ordinary needs, they are also crucial because they are crucibles of inwardly generated identity. You become what you are to your beloved. Incidentally, you might want to note that on page 39, he basically turns this into a critique of Iris Marion Young. She uses the word recognition too, but Taylor says that versions of recognition like hers are just too weak. She basically just wants recognition for a lot of people's justice claims, but they're merely liberal claims about rights and discrimination and so on. And she doesn't like impartial Rawlsian universality, that's for sure. But Taylor says that people like her still eventually just want to create a universal culture. Now it's simply one in which more people get to talk about justice. So they're not really seeing people as deeply situated in the cultures that they're a part of, but as part of a sort of universal culture that should pay more attention to their justice claims. What should we do instead? Well, he argues on 62 to 64 for what he calls a more hospitable variant of liberalism. But it turns out to be a variant that a lot of people, especially future authors on our syllabus, say pulls the argument in a non-liberal direction. A lot of people find that attractive, and some of you may as well. It's what he calls the politics of recognition, a term that we'll see recurring in a bunch of our texts. He says that recognition for the culture a person truly has, ascribing real value to who they are, has now become a definable social good that a society has to take care to distribute. Equally, he says, like a Rawlsian might distribute material goods and rights, but take care to distribute nonetheless. And misrecognition, he says, does a palpable harm to an individual, so society also has to be concerned about creating rights or other sorts of protections against misrecognition. What he's saying is in this sense liberal in that it can be expressed in terms of distributions and rights and so forth, but he's now applying that argument to a new social good. And in another sense, it moves beyond liberalism to talk about alleviating cultural domination and oppression. On page 65, for instance, he references Frantz Fanon, who we'll read later, who Taylor credits with the idea that, quote, the major weapon of the colonizers was the imposition of their image of the colonized on the subjugated people. Or in other words, Fanon was saying that what was wrong about colonialism was not just that the resources were taken and that rights weren't distributed, which a liberal like Rawls could agree was a critique of colonialism. It was more. It was that a negative identity was ascribed to people and internalized by them. That's what we'll see Fanon say. In Taylor's terminology, there was no recognition of the value of who they were. Okay, to illustrate all this, I'm going to close out with one example from the text. It starts on page 42, but carries throughout the rest of the argument, really. Taylor talks about a literary critic named Saul Bellow. You might not know that he was sort of a moral conservative back in his day. And Taylor talks about a condescending statement that Bellow had written. When the Zulus produce a Tolstoy, we will read him. On page 71, much later, Taylor says there are two obvious problems with Bellow's statement. First, that the Zulus have to produce a Tolstoy, or in other words, someone who's measurable as excellent by European standards. And then second, the assumption that they haven't produced that literary figure yet. And how the hell would Bello know? He hasn't been reading them. So a couple of those diagnoses, he says, are simple. But the moral solution to the problem is a lot more complex. Bello doesn't have to just drop the ethnocentrism, as it were. He has to, in Taylor's words, fuse horizons with others in order to sort of recognize them as they are. So he says this on page 67. He says, when we fuse horizons, what we have formerly taken for granted as the background to valuation, or in other words, Eurocentrism, can be situated as one possibility alongside the different backgrounds of the formerly unfamiliar culture. The fusion of horizons operates through our developing new vocabularies of comparison by means of which we can articulate these contrasts. So recognition, he says, requires new vocabularies. That's something that points to the linguistic side of his theory, but it also suggests that the theory is different than structuralism, as I said before. Here, a sort of act of creative identification with others can, in a certain sense, break us out of our own cultural language, break us out of the structure of meaning that had, up until that moment, made us who we are and had made us ascribe certain identities to others. And why should we do this? Why value other cultures by fusing horizons with them? Well, Taylor says on 66 and also on 72 to 73 that we should presume that all human cultures that have animated whole societies over some considerable stretch of time have something important to say to all human beings. Now, he says that we should presume this, but he also says that we could still find, even after fusing our horizons with them, that they don't have much of value to add to other humans, but he suspects that they will. And this motivates him to say, quite unlike Kimlicka, that there's something almost intrinsically valuable about cultures, quite apart from the value that they provide to the individuals who make them up. From Taylor's perspective, we might just want to see the long-standing cultures preserved because they, presumably at least, contain within them something that speaks to the human experience and to the human condition. And I'll just point out to you again here, the need for recognition is what he takes to sort of define the human condition. And then Taylor just wants to add one more thing to that, one really important thing, that we should recognize the holders of these cultures and the holders of all cultures as they are, that is, as themselves the protectors of a valuable tradition. So there you have it, folks. Two videos about two multiculturalisms, one liberal, one moving in a non-liberal direction. I can't wait to discuss them with you in class. And I'll remind you now, they form the basis of quite a few of the arguments that we're actually going to see moving forward.